All right, we are live. This is Joe Wilson along with Lee Devonald for Marmoset Co. And we're going to show you guys some of the features of this skin shader and just kind of general character setup here, along with hair and lighting and all sorts of cool stuff. So I've got this awesome. I've got this awesome model here from Yuri Alexander. You guys should check out his site, yurialexander.com, to see more of his work. So right now I've got it set up with just a real basic Lambertian shader, just the basic inputs, normal, gloss, and AO and cavity. So one of the first things that's kind of useful for skin is setting up a detail normal map. You just kind of take like a generic skin texture here, and then you can tile it with the detail tiling thing here, which gives you like that really fine grain skin texture, and you can use that to make it look like it's a lot more high resolution than it actually is. I don't know if this is really coming through here. It's kind of small. Yeah, and you can also mask that with this detail weight thing. So right now I've got the lips masked off because lips have kind of that crackly lip texture that is really specific to the lips, and you wouldn't want like that fine grain skin texture to show up there. And then we have the gloss map, which really, for skin, what you really want to do is kind of think of the gloss map as like an oil map. So like the more oily the skin is, the tighter the reflections get. Lee, do you want to talk about that a little?
Yeah, sure. I mean, so when it comes to skin has different layers. You've obviously got your diffusion pass, which Joe will go over in a minute, but when it comes to reflectivity, you really have two different layers that the light bounces off of. When light first hits the skin, it primarily bounces off of the oily layer above the skin, and then it bounces off the skin itself as well. So what we've found, we've done a bit of research, and we've looked through loads of different tech papers, and it's something that you can observe yourself just by looking at people as well. A lot of people tend to have sort of different regions of their face will be you can almost like find average oil values that you can put on pretty much everyone's face and kind of work from there. It's something that it's one of those things where as an artist you want to look at the gloss map and think about what looks best, but also realize that because this is PBR, you can find properly measured values out there. I think we posted some of those up in the stream we did last week with Matthias. So That's something that you definitely want to go and look at, is try and find the measured values for different facial areas when it comes to making your gloss maps for skin.
Yeah, and that will kind of also vary. It'll vary a bit depending on exactly how your shader is set up. Like if you're using GGX or if you're using Blinfong, because the gloss response is a little different, and it'll also vary depending on how like oily or sweaty you want the character to look. So like if it's like a boxer and he's got sweat dripping down his face, you're going to want to go with a tighter gloss map, and you're going to probably want to put like some of that sweat detail into the actual gloss map and things like that. But yeah, they're kind of generally for everyone. The same parts of the face tend to get oily, like under the eyes and things like that, so you want to kind of show that with with just brighter values in the map. And you probably can't see it here, but there's also a lot of like micro noise type detail in the gloss map to really break up those reflections. Yeah. Okay, so with the gloss basically covered, talk about the spec map a bit. Generally, with your spec map, the values should be really, really even. They could even be more. It could basically be a flat color for this type of skin shader. That's because really the reflectivity of skin doesn't really change. It's mostly the gloss in terms of like oil and things like that. So you really don't want to put much detail into your spec map.
Yeah, pretty much that.
Yeah.
It's the same is true of most materials. The only thing that will really change the reflective value of something is if you have multiple layers of materials. In the case of skin, obviously you have the skin and then you have the oil, and if you're sweating, then you have a layer of moisture as well. But the variance in reflectivity is so small that you really wouldn't notice it. So for skin, you can if your character is mapped so that you have skin areas in some places and you know, other materials in other places on the same texture map, absolutely you would want to you would want to have the different reflective values in your map. But if, you know, for the sake of this example, you could probably even get away with removing the specular map and just setting a flat value for the entire face, and you probably wouldn't notice very much difference at all from having the spec map in there.
Yeah, so here I've dropped the spec map out entirely, and you can see that you can get basically the same look in that. Yeah, and so like piercings or something like, so when you have a metal object embedded into the skin, that'd be a really good example of a time when you would want a different reflectivity value other than skin. And what is the like standard reflectivity value of skin? It's pretty low, right?
Yeah, it's like 0.028. It's really, really low.
Yeah.
For the most part, you can actually get away with just using like the metalness workflow and having it set to I think it's like 0.04. But if you want to go as exact as you can, the linear value is 0.028.
Yeah. Another cool thing you can do with skin, and I've got it set up here, is the secondary reflection. Right now I've got it set up so that there's a primary reflection, and it's a pretty broad reflection. But I also have a secondary layer of more of a tight reflection, which kind of it mimics in a way like that layer of oil that's on top of the skin as well. So this is just kind of an extra little thing that you can do, and you can this you have to just kind of eyeball to get it to like the right setting there.
This is something that we, as we look at our skin shaders as well, we've gotten a lot of feedback over the last few months about the skin shader and the way it works, and that's one of the reasons why we're doing this video. But another thing is to see if there's any way that we can improve it at all. So with skin in particular in mind, one thing that we are looking at doing is maybe trying to merge in the secondary reflection so that it's more streamlined for the artist. So you only use the one like gloss value, and it covers the broad skin layer as well as the oily layer. Yeah. Just with the one map. So it's something that we're conscious of and are looking at maybe changing. But we also like the flexibility that you have with the secondary reflection.
Right. So another thing that's pretty important when it comes to specularity and reflectivity in general is the cavity map. Here you see we'll have a really fine detail map of basically all the little pits and pores in the skin. And that helps to just break up the reflection here so it's not so even and smooth. And this might be kind of hard to see here, but yeah. It really helps to just break it up a bit. And though when you use a cavity map like this, you really probably should not put it into the diffuse, because you get like this weird, strange color multiplying into the diffuse. And it's just like, that just looks weird, right? So this is, when you're setting up skin, like, you want your cavity map to pretty much just mask your reflectivity for the most part.
Yeah, it's probably worth mentioning the reason for that. As Joe said, it's because the way the cavity map works is through multiplication. So if the black values in your cavity map equal zero, that multiplies on top of whichever channel it's being applied to. So if you're multiplying your diffuse by zero, then the result is going to be zero, and you're going to get that weird sort of black look. But this isn't just limited to skin. If you're applying a cavity map to any material, when you multiply down to zero, the result is going to be black. So that's something to bear in mind with the way cavity works in general. The reason why it works so well with breaking up the reflectivity is because it still multiplies down to zero. It's only multiplying the reflection down to zero, and the reflection doesn't go to black. You can't have a black reflection. You just have no reflection. Right. And that's the difference between the diffuse and specular cavity channels.
Yes. Yes, and we've also have just kind of a standard baked AO ambient occlusion map here that it really what ambient occlusion does in Toolbag, and this isn't actually necessarily typical in every renderer, but it only multiplies on the ambient contribution of the image based lighting of the sky lighting. So when you don't have any lights, any direct lights in the scene, you're going to see the effect of this map more so, but it does not affect dynamic lights, just because it doesn't really make sense for it to affect dynamic lights. But yeah, that's the basic AO and cavity workflow stuff. We recently have added GGX specular as an alternative to Blin Fong. Lee, do you want to show a bit of that?
Yeah, sure. So one of the things we've added recently is GGX. Now, this is it's very close to being there, but just be aware that this is, you know, we're still in the kind of prototyping, beta testing kind of stage with this. So the left sphere here is the default Blin Fong, and the right sphere is the GGX. What I'll do for now is I'll just turn off the image based lighting so that you can get a better view of what exactly is going on. The biggest thing to bear in mind is the difference in highlight shape. With Blin Fong, you tend to have all the way from full glossy to extremely rough. You tend to have this kind of really tight highlight, and the secondary fall off or the tail is also quite tight. It kind of hugs that highlight quite closely, and that goes all the way through to sort of full roughness. And the other thing to notice is that at full roughness, you kind of have this outer limit to where the reflection is going to end. With GGX, it's slightly different. The roughness response is, I would say, it's much more sensitive. That's probably the best way to think of it. So as you can see, even with a very small change to the roughness value, as we're going from gloss down to rough, you can see it's already got quite a broad tail. If I bring the Fong up to match, the tails are completely different. The highlight shapes are very different between the two. And as you start heading out towards full roughness, you'll notice that a lot more of the sphere is covered by the highlight shape, until eventually, when you reach full roughness, you have this huge area that's completely covered by the highlight. So that's basically the difference between the two. The reason we've added this is to kind of add some parity between the different rendering engines that are out there that are using GGX or are using a form of GGX. So we're trying to match as closely as possible so that you can maximize your time developing. You can preview everything quickly and efficiently with Toolbag before moving into your engine of choice. But I think the reason a lot of people are going with GGX is partly down to this kind of roughness response or gloss response, whichever term you want to use. It's, from my understanding, it's much more closely matched to the response of pure chromium, which was measured in a lab somewhere, and Disney got their hands on all of this data and went, well, you know, we want something that, that matches, you know, these pure values as closely as possible, and that's why we went with this. It's not to everyone's taste, though. A lot of people still like the default Fong, so take your pick, I guess.
Yeah, and also this is what Unreal 4 uses, so we've been doing a lot of research on our end trying to just sync up that workflow so that you will be able to texture your assets and preview them in Toolbag really quickly and then send them off to Unreal and have very closely matched results. And we're going to do kind of a different feature on specifically that sometime in the future when this is all in and finished and everything. But yeah, that's one of the big reasons why we have added GGX.
Yep. We got a couple of questions in here. Let's have a look what we got. So this is actually a very good question. What's the difference between putting fine detail in the cavity map versus multiplying your cavity into your reflectivity map or into your spec map? I know it's counter to the PBR workflow, but wouldn't it be the same thing?
I suppose essentially that would be the same thing. The where you really have a problem there is if you have the metalness, if you're using the metalness workflow, then you wouldn't have the ability to do that at all. So you would have to rely on a cavity map. Lee, can you think of any big differences there?
I think the other big difference is control.
Yeah.
Just like in Toolbag, you have the cavity map input as well as the slider that goes with it. You can do the same kind of thing in UE4. You can do the same thing in CryEngine as well. You just get more control when you have the map separate to the specular input. It just allows you to make things more closely match the way that you actually want them.
Yep. All right. Should we move on to the skin shader specific stuff now? I think we got a lot of questions on PolyCount kind of about the skin shader, and I think that a lot of them will be answered with what everything that we plan to cover here, but I've also got a list of kind of questions to go over that I'll double check when I'm done with this kind of section here. The first thing I want to kind of talk about is scale. So in Toolbag, the skin shader is very much dependent on scale. And it's hard for me to show that here because I don't have two objects of different scales, but what it really means is that like the settings like normal smoothing, or sorry, like shadow blur are going to be really dependent on how big your model is. So if you load in a very large mesh, you might see that the normal the shadow blur setting only adjusts from like this range to this range. And if you're seeing that, that means that your model is probably too big. And if it's real small, it might look kind of a lot like this, where it's just really blurry. I'll try to post up a link to like a simple scale reference object that I use. Just we don't support scaling inside of Toolbag yet, so you just kind of have to scale it in your 3D app before importing it. So that's one real important thing to know. There's another issue with specifically with field of view that the scale also, you can kind of see how the shadow blurriness differs as I move further away from the object and adjust the field of view or the focal length of the lens. That is kind of a technical issue, and it's something I've logged in our bug system here. I'm not sure what can be done with about it, but it's just something that you should kind of be aware of. So when you're setting up your scene, just try to stick to probably within a fairly small range of field of views for your different cameras. Like, so like you probably wouldn't want a camera with like a 24 millimeter focal length and another with a 200 millimeter focal length, because you'd get a really big difference, really big discrepancy in how the settings, like the shadow blur, affect the shader and show up in the viewport. Okay, so with that out of the way, let's just kind of go through all of the basic settings in the skin shader. Oh, and if anyone doesn't know how to get the skin shader, you just click this little drop down in the diffusion module and just change it from Lambertian to skin. Okay, so the first component of the skin shader is the subdermis scatter. And what this does is it's really a blend between Lambertian and the skin shader. So as you adjust it, you're really just setting how strong the effect of the skin shader is going to be, and also the skin shader scatter setting sets kind of the color of like the bottom layer of the skin, or more accurately the color of the shadow area, like as the model fades from light into the shadowed area, you kind of tint that color. So this is usually you'll want to make a subdermis map, and you want to set that color there. We got a question on PolyCount about the energy conservation with this, and you can kind of see how as your subdermis color gets more saturated, the lit parts of the skin actually shift to a different color. Lee, do you want to talk about the reason why that is a little bit?
Yeah, sure. It's a little bit sciencey, the answer, so I'll try and simplify it a little bit. And this is a fun experiment that you can do at home if you have kids and stuff like that. It's actually actually comes from an experiment that a scientist did a long, long time ago to try and figure out, you know, why is the sky blue? And so what he did was he filled up a goldfish bowl or a fish tank with some water and put some milk into it just to cloud it a little bit. And he shone a light through from one side of the tank. And what he observed was that the color of the milk closest to the light was very blue, and the color of the light furthest away from the color of the milk furthest away from the light source started tinting towards red. And that was kind of like our basis of understanding the light spectrum and how it works. So in the most basic of terms, what we know is that red light travels further than blue light. And how that regards to the skin shader is that when you tint your subdermis map, the color that you choose to tint the map determines how far the different channels of color travel across the surface. So in this case, we're using a pink color, and you can see that the pink color travels quite far around. And what you're left with is a very blue hue towards the center of the highlight. When you can change that up, you don't have to use a pink subdermis. If you were doing some kind of crazy alien that had blue skin, you could absolutely use a blue color. But what you would notice from the blue as your subdermis color is that actually the blue doesn't actually travel quite as far as the red. So you can see here the red color is way more saturated in the central highlight than the blue in the shadow. So that's kind of like the sciencey background behind it. It's basically put your color into the subdermis map and the light will travel based on that color. That's how the energy conservation works. You can't when one channel of light passes around the skin, the other channels of light have to become more prominent in your view, you know, because right. you can't kind of expect that those lights to just disappear. They have to go somewhere, and if they're not traveling as far, they're staying in the center and they become more prominent.
So, yeah, so that's the basic technical reasoning behind it. I think a lot of people, it's just kind of weird and different to them when they start using it. So it's kind of like alarming, I guess. But
yeah.
I think, so another part of that question was like, how do you avoid it or counteract it? So one of the important things to kind of keep in mind is that like when you load up the skin shader, all the values are kind of cranked up pretty high. So the easiest thing to do is just tone back a bit on the saturation. And then also if you have, so I'm going to just switch over to the fully textured material here where we actually have a subdermis map. So you can see here that like the more fleshy areas of like the ears and such, those are much brighter in the subdermis map. So the effect of that subdermis is going to be a lot higher. And then with the rest of the skin, it's not quite so bright. And I think something that people probably do quite a bit is load a map that looks kind of like this, but then also have an additional multiplier on it. So like an additional red multiplier on top of that, which kind of makes the problem seem worse than it is if you have red on top of red. But yeah, I think the easiest thing you can do to kind of counteract that is just make sure that you're not going really overboard with the settings. Switch back here. So if we just set the subdermis scatter down a bit, because really like at the max subdermis scatter,
it's almost like a jellyfish.
What were you saying the other day, Lee, that like skin is a lot more dense than we probably
I mean you've got to think that what this is simulating essentially is light passing through the skin, bouncing around the muscle tissues and the subdermis tissues, and then coming back out somewhere further along the line. But a lot of people kind of overestimate how far the light actually travels before it comes back. So what they tend to do is they oversaturate their subdermis maps, and they kind of have everything cranked up that little bit too high, and that gives you that really kind of jelly-like feel.
Yeah, the really waxy look.
Yeah, I mean that's not to say that there aren't things out there that have these properties. You know, talking about, you know, alien creatures again, if you wanted to make some kind of weird fish alien that had like really, really kind of waxy, very kind of jellyish skin, then go nuts. You know, the whole, you know, one of the most fun things about this tool is that you can really kind of go out there and make some crazy awesome things. But what you need to bear in mind when it comes to real people and real skin values is that actually our skin is quite dense. The light doesn't travel very far, so try to avoid having ridiculously high values, and you'll get that more realistic response from the material.
Yeah, that sums it up pretty well. Okay, so that is the subdermis map, and that's what it does. And again, this subdermis scatter value is really just a kind of a global how fleshy the skin is, basically, value, and the color of the fleshiness of the skin and all that sort of stuff.
That's just to make people aware as well. That's also something that can be controlled in the subdermis map. If you bring up the other material again, by lowering the, you know, you can see with this subdermis map, it's got a fair amount of saturation, but it's not overly bright either. It's it's almost like a mid range. So, what that means is that if you were to crank up the brightness on that texture, you would start getting that jelly like effect again, because the subdermis scatter level kind of goes up. So the best thing you can really do is keep the scatter level at 1, have the color set to white, and then work within the subdermis map and try and get that as close to the values as you actually want. Or you know if you're not sure what values you want, play around with the slider, play around with the color picker, and then transpose those into your subdermis map. But just be aware that you can multiply the effect down to zero just by having, you know, a black spot in the subdermis map.
Right. So yeah. So the subdermis map sets both the intensity and the color of the subdermis effect. And you can also put a black and white map into the alpha channel if you want to mask off a section. Like, again, if you have like a hair or piercing that's like embedded into the skin, but you can't assign a different material to it, you'd want to like have it black. You can actually do it two ways. You can have like just a black and white mask in the alpha channel, or you can just have a completely black value in the RGB values for those sort of materials. Okay, I think that's probably enough for the subdermis map. So next up is the normal smoothing, and what this does is it blurs the base normal map to kind of soften up the skin. Basically, it's important to note that it only blurs the diffuse contribution of the lighting, though. See the specular reflections here, they don't get blurrier or anything like that. So you're really just kind of softening the diffuse lighting. And again, this is something that can look pretty weird if you crank it up too high, but it really helps to kind of make sure you don't have like that really clay and hard edge look to what is actually a very soft surface. And then the shadow blur is a really hugely important component of the skin shader, I believe. Again, this is really heavily dependent on scale, so make sure that you have your mesh scale set up correctly. I've seen some people set this like to a kind of a really high value. But when I do this, what I really try, and you can see that as you get really high, it gets, I'm not sure if this will come through, but it gets kind of a really grainy, noisy look. And that's because this is, it's a screen space blur. And I think there's kind of a noise texture applied on it to get rid of like banding artifacts, basically. So if you go really high, you're gonna really see that noise texture. But what I like to do is kind of set it just high enough so that that the artifacts of the shadow mapping, so that they kind of go away, and that like the transition from the lit to shadowed area is really smooth. But I still like to have this really distinct shadow here, like around the nose, that so that you can really just see the lighting. Yeah. And then occlusion blur is, it kind of softens the, this is based here. I'll crank this real quick here. This is based on the actual, the screen space ambient occlusion setting. So what this does is it does a screen space blur pass on that ambient occlusion. So you can kind of soften up that screen. Is that right, Lee?
Yeah, that's pretty much it. Okay. The important thing to bear in mind there is the ambient occlusion, as we previously mentioned, only affects the ambient contribution from IBL. So it's really easily washed out by having too many direct lights in the scene. So if you're seeing that the occlusion blur doesn't appear to be doing very much, it's probably because it's being washed out by the direct lights in the scene.
Yeah, you can see here that it's really most noticeable in these areas of shadow here, and in the very brightly lit areas of the model, you don't really see it much at all. Whoops. There we go. Yeah. So. So translucency is another kind of really complex part of the skin shader here. Let me just set this back to reasonable value. Okay, so the way, first off, I'll show you, just crank up translucency. So by default, the sky translucency comes on at 1, which is way too high. I usually turn this down like almost to 0, because it's translucency that's coming from the ambient image based lighting, and that means that it's kind of coming from all directions, which just doesn't really tend to look good. It just makes everything look red more than it has a really specific desirable effect. So I'll usually turn that down pretty far. And for the main translucency setting, usually you're going to want to have a map to control this. So Nald actually does a really good, what is it? Is it called a transmission map in Nald?
Yeah, it's called a, I'll load Nald and find out. I believe it's called a transmission. Yeah, Nald it. I believe it's called a transmission map, just bear with me 2 seconds.
Yeah, so Nald has this function that you can bake a thickness map, basically. So you see, like, the ears, the ears are very thin, and they're all basically cartilage. There's no bone in there to like block light from bouncing through, right? So yep. Those areas would be really bright in this sort of this thickness map, and what that does is it really controls how much of the translucency, how strong the translucency effect is. You can also use this map to set, like, similar to the subdermis map, you can set the both the strength and the color in this map. Right now, I've just got it the strength in as a grayscale, and then the color in as a parametric input, so that I can actually tweak the color. So you can see how the translucency effect changes when you set it to a different color. There is kind of a limitation to our current translucency effect, and that is that right now, if you turn on shadow casting for a light, it pretty much blocks the reflection from, or the translucency from, like a back facing light like this. This is kind of an unfortunate technical restraint, and I think we're going to look into seeing if we can improve this, but I'm not sure what is really feasible at this point. But so if you want to do this effect where you get, like, the really glowing red ear from, like, a strong backlight, what I did here was I set up a light that does not cast shadows and just shines very specifically only on the ear, and I've set the radius up so that it's just hitting that ear. So this is kind of a really hacky solution to do this, but it still works. And I'll show you what happens when you have a large light that kind of shines on everything, and you don't have shadow casting. You get this just really strange look where the light is coming through the skull, even though the bone structure and the muscle structure of the face would block a lot, like, this light from bleeding through this much. So so this is just kind of so what we do is we mask the translucency with the shadow map, which, again, it's unfortunate for, like, very specific effects, like a glowing ear from a backlit source, but it's just kind of a technical restraint that we have to deal with for now. But we're going to look into seeing what we can do there. There's also the translucency scatter function, and this is just kind of here, I'll switch to the other material. It's a little easier to see. Just kind of like a curve on how tight that translucency is. It's kind of it's a pretty subtle effect, though.
Basically, how far inwards from the edge of the reflect does it happen? It's probably the easiest way to explain it. So the lower that number is, the more you'll see kind of like a thin line towards the edge of the effect, and the higher the number is, you get this kind of broad spread of the effect across the entire surface.
Yeah. Okay, so the fuzz map. What is the fuzz map?
What is the fuzz map?
What is the fuzz map? So the fuzz map is really meant to kind of simulate all those little tiny micro hairs that everyone has all over their skin, right? So it's kind of like a diffuse Fresnel, but I've been told by various programmers that that's not a thing. So, Lee, what is that other word that kind of describes it more accurately?
Do you remember? Well, actually, it is like a diffuse Fresnel.
Okay, it is like a diffuse Fresnel.
So mathematically, it uses the same math as Fresnel. The difference is, rather than multiply, which is what Fresnel would normally do, this is additive. So it's added on over the top of the diffuse path. So what that means is that it's both view and light dependent. So it's dependent on your light source. It's also dependent on the direction that you're viewing the model from. You can control like the scatter is very similar to the translucency map scatter. So you can control kind of how tight that effect is, and then you can control the occlusion of that effect as well. The occlusion is basically how much the shadow mask affects the fuzz parameter. But in the easiest sense of the term, yes, it's kind of like a simulated Fresnel effect. That's specifically for the microfibers on either skin or I think we have a microfiber diffusion profile for cloth as well.
Yeah, so you can see here with the actual content here that there's a lot of this is just basically like just basically a noise texture in here again to just really break it up. And I set the diffuse all the way down so you can just see what is happening with both the specular contribution and then this little grainy effect here is actually what the fuzz map does. And you can see how that kind of approximates like those little tiny hairs that that you have that only really show up in like certain lighting conditions. Like when you have a strong rim light on a model, you'll see that little fuzz just glow, right? So that's what the fuzz is for, and that's kind of just generally how it works. So yeah, you usually want to have some sort of texture in the map to break that effect up. And it can kind of get a little overboard if you go too high on your intensity value there, or if your map is set too high. So just watch that.
Just for the sake of demonstration, can you turn off mask with gloss at the moment?
Oh yes, sure.
So what masking with gloss does is it kind of simulates the wetness effect that gloss has on fuzzy surfaces, and you can see it when you look at things like towels or materials like velvet that have this very fuzzy appearance. When they get wet, that kind of soft sheen of light that would appear over the surface just disappears due to the wetness. So that's basically what the mask with gloss is simulating, except in the case of skin, it's taking into account the oiliness of skin and how that would diminish the effect on the hair backlighting.
Yeah, so essentially the rougher the surface is, the more the fuzz shows up, is that?
Yes, yeah, exactly. Yeah,
okay, so that's what happens when you mask it with the, when you use that mask with gloss parameter.
Yep.
Okay. So here's a question for PolyCount. What is the biggest change in authoring skin textures when moving to PBR? I think basically a lot of the stuff that we've already covered here, like the spec map should really have very even values, or you might not have a specular map at all if you're using the metalness workflow. The gloss is really where you set the structure of the surface and how oily it is, the texture of the surface, and all that stuff goes into the gloss or the roughness map if you're using a roughness map. And then beyond that, it's going to kind of depend on exactly how your shader is set up. So with our shader, we've got a bunch of inputs for like subdermis map and translucency, and as opposed to painting a lot of that detail into like your diffuse map, which you may have done with previous generation techniques, a lot of those effects are actually going to be dynamic and shader based, so that you'll have texture maps running them and they will change dynamically with the light. Do you have anything else to add to that, Lee? PBR?
Not really. With regards to the switch from non-PBR to PBR rendering with skin, just to reinforce the fact that it's about finding those kind of measured values and using them as a strong guideline for your artistic process. It doesn't by any means need to diminish what you do as an artist. You don't need to look at it as a form of constraint that kind of stops you from producing awesome stuff. Use it as a guideline to help you create even better things. And when you kind of understand what those guidelines represent, you can achieve fantastic results. So yeah, it's just about finding those baseline values and using them as a guide to sort of get you through.
Yeah, and when you are comfortable with the kind of base values, it should make it a lot faster for you to iterate and work through different characters, and because skin doesn't vary a huge degree, like the reflective properties of skin don't vary a huge degree from character to character. So once you kind of have an idea of what those values are, you should be able to kind of plug them in and get them set up pretty quickly. And I just want to kind of mention it again that like the reflectivity of skin is actually quite low. You see fairly often how like an artist will just put like a really bright reflective value on skin and it just kind of glows and it looks a little weird. So again, just be aware of like the fact that the reflectivity in skin is actually quite low, unless it's like really oily or sweaty or something like that. So it should be a really subtle effect.
I'm just trying to find something. Spare me 2 seconds. I think I found it here. This should help with what we're trying to talk about just now. All right, here we go. Here we go. So this is a slide taken from a GDC demo a few years back, courtesy of Activision Blizzard. And over here we have the gloss map for a face, and you can see that it's incredibly basic. We're kind of sat here saying, you know, put all of your variation into the gloss map, but their setup for their skin shader is basically reflectivity is one flat value for the entire fleshy area. The only variation they have is in the gloss map, but even that variation is actually very low. They basically have like a base value which is used for all areas of the skin, and then the rest are, as we said earlier, they're taken from many, many samples of people that they've photographed and measured kind of the roughness or glossiness properties of the different regions of their faces, and just kind of gauged average values from those. And what you'll find is that most people will fall within these average ranges, and once you understand that fact, you can kind of very quickly as an artist paint these ranges into your gloss map, apply them to your model, and then from there you can go, okay, so I want my character to be some kind of like greasy hobo bum who never washes, and you know, so we're going to crank up the forehead values, we're going to crank up the nose values a bit, or maybe you want to paint a picture of, you know, some guy who's just had his heart broken, and he's sat at a table drinking and crying and, you know, all that kind of stuff. So you might want to kind of go, okay, so we have like this very wet area here and that uses this value, so we're going to kind of paint that into the map to kind of simulate like tears streaming down the face or what have you. But it's about understanding what those values represent, and once you understand what those values represent, you can very quickly paint your maps and iterate changes that would have taken a lot longer with the older workflows, where, you know, you kind of had to eyeball the specular and bake all this lighting information into the specular and then kind of fudge the gloss map to match it and then go back and adjust the specular because it doesn't quite match the gloss map. And you know, you don't have to do that anymore. You can just go flat value for the skin, for the specular, and then for the glossiness you just it's just basic values and adjust to your own preference.
Yep. Yeah, so just a quick summary there. You're just going to, the shader does a lot more of the heavy lifting, and it should just, once you understand kind of the basic values, it should just be a lot quicker for you to set up materials. So it's all just kind of a win-win for everyone now that the shaders are more complex and able to handle these lighting calculations and everything in a more accurate manner.
Yep.
Okay. Let's see.
We've just got one. Where do we need to input these values? Well, with regards to reflectance, that would be in your specular intensity. But with regards to the glossiness, you would just paint those values into your gloss map.
Yes. Yes, and if you're using like the metal in this workflow, that's, you're not going to really have an option on what you set your base reflectivity value. So like everything you're going to do is going to be in the gloss map pretty much, unless unless you have an additional input or something there, but that's not really common. So there's one question here from PolyCount, and I'm not quite sure I understand it, but it says, why do I get a brighter surface under the nose, for example, if the hole is not closed? So I'm not sure if that means that the mesh is not closed, like there's an actual gap in the mesh. And if that's the case, you really want to cap that. Otherwise, it's probably not going to shadow correctly. So that's my best guess for answering that question there.
Yeah, it also, that would also affect the directions that the normals are baked at. So you would like the kind of,
yes,
the way the renderer renders those normals, it kind of expects them to be pointing a different direction to if you'd baked it with like a closed hole.
Yes. So just generally avoid uncapped holes for anything like the inside of the nose or anything like that. Okay, so now I'm going to go over the eyes here. I'll hide this main chunk here. So there's kind of a couple ways to do this, and I've actually modified Yuri's content a bit here. What he had done originally is he had modeled in the iris detail, and you can do that, and it's cool, but I'm going to show you a slightly different thing to do here. So the basic concept that I do when I use when I set up eyes is I have two layers. You have like the underneath layer, which is just the fleshy eyeball bit, and then there's the outer layer, which is like the glossy coating on top. It's just the wet layer on top, right? So to do that, what I do is I make a duplicate material for the outer shell. And I load in like just a basic color into the displacement map section. I changed the displacement from none to height here. And then you can use that to scale it up. So you just want to make it slightly bigger just so it doesn't, you don't get any like Z-fighting or weird issues there. And then what you want to do is set the transparency, or first off, you want to just think about this as like it's just a reflectivity pass. So you can set the albedo to black to kind of preview what this is going to look like. And then to get this to add on top, you just set the transparency mode to add. And what that does is it renders the reflections on top of the mesh that's behind it, and because it's additive, it shouldn't have any problems with like sorting or anything like that, just as long as that mesh is a little bigger than the one behind it. So what you can do there is you can use the bottom layer can actually have a unique normal map for the iris detail and things like that. And another really cool thing you can do, and you kind of see it as I move to the side here, is you can set up the parallax effect on this inner eye mesh with just a simple little parallax map that has an indent in the center of the iris to give you this sort of this like lens reflection sort of effect that is seen from the side, which is kind of what eyeballs look like. And it might be a little subtle to see when I'm moving around here, but it just gives that extra depth to the actual eyeball itself. So that's the way I like to do it. You can model that shape in. You can use two different layers and model that shape in. But then I find it hard to get this like the refraction sort of effect from when viewing from the side. So I like to do it with the parallax thing. And another little just nice trick to do is to model in a little yeah, it's kind of hard to see. Model in a strip, just a wet strip along the intersection of the head and the eyes, and this gives you just that little glint of like wetness. It's probably pretty hard to see, but yeah, I just use another similar material to like the shell material, where it's just an additive blending material there. You get that just little here, let me turn off the lights quickly. You can kind of see just the reflections from the image based lighting, and you can see that glint just show up like right there. I think that is really helpful in making, kind of grounding the eyes in the head, really. Yeah, so that is my basic basic eyeball setup. There's more ways to do it than that, but I find that works pretty well.
It's a fairly quick and cheap way of doing it as well.
Yeah. Oh, and another thing that you can do is because you have two different layers, you can have unique. I mentioned this already, but you can have like a unique normal map for the iris detail, and then you can have a unique normal map on the outer shell too, to give it kind of a grainy texture, which helps to break up the reflections. This might be a little hard to see here, but yeah, see how this is not just a perfectly smooth shape? That really helps add just that extra bit of realism to the eyeballs. And I don't think we had any questions regarding eyes, so I'll just move on to the hair stuff now.
Hair.
Hair is
hair is an ongoing topic of discussion at, yes, Marmoset.
Yes, so we are currently looking into what we can do in terms of hair shading, and it's kind of a very complex issue, but I'll go and I'll show you what I've managed to do with our existing shader system. So here is just the basic Blinfong hair, just a really standard material. One of the most important things with hair is actually the reflections, and you want them to be anisotropic. So if you go down to the reflection module, you can set it from Blinfong or GGX and turn it to anisotropic, and what that does is it gives you hair or highlights that kind of run along the shape of the hair, as opposed to just, you know, a big round highlight. Lee, do you want to kind of explain the concept of that a little bit?
No. Well, basically the anisotropic shader, it simulates essentially like a rough kind of cylindrical shape that's ingrained into an object. If you ever see things like scratched metal, aluminium cans, you know, that kind of thing, you'll notice that the highlights, that you have like two highlights on them most of the time. You'll have like that very fong-shaped central highlight, but then you'll also have this kind of weird thin line kind of banded highlight around the object. And that's what the anisotropic shader simulates, is that kind of cylindrical straight line across the object kind of highlight. It's really, really useful for hair.
Yeah, so here I've got it set up with so there's kind of two ways to do anisotropic highlights. You can load in a direction map, which looks kind of weird in something like this. There's kind of a ongoing problem with creating hair content, and it's how do you generate or paint direction maps? And my answer is, I don't know. It's not very helpful. I asked Yuri how he did this, and I think he says, I don't remember.
So, well, I think the given way at the moment is... it's kind of like a hack in Photoshop. You can find a tutorial on how to do it
On
Ben Mathis' website. That's www.poopinmymouth.com. So you can find a tutorial on how to paint a direction map there. But essentially, painting a direction map allows you to simulate multiple directions within the same texture. Whereas if you don't have the directional map, you're limited to the functionality of picking one highlight direction to use for the entire texture.
Yeah, and that actually can work quite well. Here, let me just clear out the the directional, there's an anisotropy direction slider in the shader, and if your UVs are all generally running in the same direction, which they are here, you can kind of get away with this. But if you have a bit more complex shape, you really want to have some sort of painted or generated direction map. And really for more complex types of hair, say like braids, that if you have like a braid hair chunk that's kind of modeled as one chunk and the UVs don't all run in the same direction, it's really difficult to represent that without using some sort of directional map content. So right now I have the primary and secondary reflection set to anisotropic, and this actually lets me do something pretty cool. First off, I can adjust the gloss for this secondary layer independently, and I can also adjust the color, and as well as there's this little slider down here for refraction shift that shifts the primary highlight away from the secondary. And this is really helpful for getting that that sheen of hair, I think. Lee, can you tell everyone why it's important for the secondary to have the colored highlight?
Yeah, so hair is, just like every other non-metallic substance out there, primarily a white reflective material. The primary reflection that you'll see is a white reflection. It's not tinted by the base albedo value. The reason why the secondary highlight is tinted is because it's not actually a reflective highlight. What's actually happening is the light is entering the hair at the point of the first reflection. It's then traveling down and bouncing around inside the hair, and it's coming back out of the hair further down the strand. And because it's bounced around inside and then it's come back out further down the strand, that's how it takes on the color properties of the hair itself, and that's why the second highlight is tinted.
Yeah, so it's just, that's just another one of those kind of physically based things that we try to implement into the content here. So that's kind of the basics for the reflectivity. I talked briefly about the different transparency methods. So there's basically two types of transparency here that you would want to use for hair. The first one is cutout, which is really just like alpha testing. So it's either on or off, and you can adjust the threshold here for that effect. And that's not really great most of the time. And the second is the dithered method, which it looks noisy in the viewport, especially when you're moving around and it doesn't have any time to settle. But when it's rendered out, it actually gets sampled a bunch of times and smooths out. Right now, this is our best way to do transparency for hair. And one of the really big things that it has going for it is that it is completely order independent. And what that means is, unlike traditional alpha blending, you can have as many planes overlapping as you want like this, and you'll never have any problems with the planes popping in and out behind each other, sorting incorrectly. So that's one of the main reasons we wanted to implement this mode. But we realized people aren't real big fans of the kind of noisy look to it, so we might look and do some alternatives there as well.
Yeah, one of the things we have kind of in our minds, and this was specifically with regards to hair, we're not sure if this is something that will affect other ways of sorting out the alpha, is that we kind of thought maybe we could blur the dithered alpha based on the anisotropic direction. So if you have your hair strands running down and the anisotropic direction matches it, then the dithered alpha would blur perpendicular to that, so you'd get kind of like a nice soft blur, and it would match the direction of the hair. We're kind of looking into other ways that we can make it work with other materials as well as just hair, but it's something that we're consciously aware of.
Yeah, we just have to do a bit more research on it on our end here. Okay, so let's go over some of the other just kind of pitfalls of dealing with hair. So when you have just a basic shader like this, which is just a Lambertian shader, you get this kind of just gross lighting and shadowing to it. So what I actually like to do is use the skin shader again, because you get a lot of control over like the shadow blur and things like that. So you see all these kind of nasty artifacts, and like hair is very thin and it doesn't self-shadow like in these big groups of planes like we kind of have to construct hair for games. You know, it's just a mass of just very small strands of hair that just do like basically like micro occlusion on each other. So there isn't really any way to represent that without having all of the hair, all the bits of hair modeled individually. So one of the things you can do to kind of get around that is just use the shadow blur parameter to kind of just smooth it out. I think that helps the look considerably. I'm also using the normal smoothing on here a bit too, just again so that it's gonna be kind of hard to see, it's a pretty subtle effect, but just so the hair doesn't look kind of concretey, just so it softens the look of the hair out. And if I actually loaded the albedo map into the translucency map here, because again, hair doesn't tend to have these like real dark, thick shadows, right? So I'm just using the translucency to kind of fill in this shaded area, and that, I think that helps a lot. We've also got the fuzz here to just kind of simulate like that sort of a how this is similar to with the small micro hairs on skin. Little bits of hair tend to catch light from like rear light sources, so we're just using the fuzz to kind of give that just a bit of sheen as well. That this can kind of go, it can kind of look weird if you go overboard with it.
It's clever tricks to create the illusion of backlighting.
Yes. Yes. To get this is a common question. So to enable double-sided materials for hair, you actually want to go to the, just click on the object itself and then disable this cull back faces option here, and that will render a double-sided material. There's some technical issues with our shadowing system. Right now, these shadows actually... Ooh, that's weird. Okay.
wow.
Yep. So right now, the hair doesn't actually correctly cast shadows onto the face most of the time. With the contact refinement option, it kind of helps it a bit in certain cases. And the ambient occlusion helps quite a bit as well. But that's just something to kind of be aware of that. Yeah, see, like most of the shadow there along this, really the hair should be shadowing the face here, but it's not. Just kind of a technical restriction that we have dealing with the shadow mapping system that we use. So I don't really have a solution for that. You can manually duplicate and flip the hair planes, and I think that issue kind of goes away, but you get a different sort of shadowing issue where both of those sides of the planes kind of fight with each other and shadow each other, and it looks really bad. So I would really suggest just doing the no cull, just to turn off the culling on back faces instead of manually duplicating, because that has artifacts that are, in my opinion, worse than the kind of the minor issues that we have here. There was one question from PolyCount. I realized that when I have mipmaps disabled, hair works better. Why is that? I think the basic thing, actually, this is kind of true in general of Toolbag too. You can kind of go through and disable mipmaps on like all of your stuff. And because when we export rendered images, we do really crazy super sampling, like 26 times or 15 times or whatever you set it to. It that does its own kind of natural filtering, which is what the mip mapping is usually there, so that you don't get really like the moire lines where the texture resolution is higher than your screen's resolution. So when you render it out, it samples it, and it does just really nice filtering, and so that's probably why you notice a little bit different results when disabling the mipmaps. Okay, this might be a little hard to show. So we're working on a cloth shader, and it's applied to her dress right now. It's not really done yet. It's just something that Lee's working on, but we just wanted to mention that. Cloth shader, we're trying to make one. It's going to be cool. Yay.
Yeah. Well, we're hoping it's going to be cool.
Yeah. It's not cool. It's probably Lee's fault.
Yeah. No, the idea behind it is that... The way we render cloth in Toolbag at the moment isn't entirely physically accurate, because you're relying on the microsurface the microfiber diffusion profile, which gives you that that fake Fresnel that we were talking about earlier. So it's not physically accurate at all. So we're working on a physically accurate cloth specific BRDF, which will allow you to simulate just about any range of cloth, all the way from velvet at the far rough end, and I think silk will be the kind of shiniest material that you can go for. But we're having a couple of issues right now. It's very very prototypey, very work in progress, and we're aware of that, and we're working to make it better.
Yeah, so you can kind of see it just a little bit here, how you get sort of the inverse highlights with the really low gloss values. But we want to. There's still some technical stuff we want to.
It looks very different. If you turn off the image based lighting, the effect becomes much more pronounced.
Oh yeah. Yeah, then you can kind of we can go through the whole gloss range. Yeah. We will show this off properly when it has a little more
when
work.
When it's ready, when it's done.
When it's ready, it's, yep. When it's
still
done.
Cooking.
Yeah.
Could I just pick up on a...
Oh, sorry.
Sorry, could I just pick up on a pitfall with hair?
Oh, sure, real quick. Absolutely.
If you just want to switch to my screen real quick.
Okay. 1 second. All right, there we go.
Cool. Right. So here is. Hang on. I think I may have just. No, that's fine. Right. So here is a photograph of my daughter's hair. This is the kind of response that you'd expect to see under general lighting conditions. It looks like there's an extreme kind of range of saturations, and the highlights are very bright and everything. So what I did was I hacked together a very crude cross-polarized filter, which basically takes out all of the specular highlights, or as much of them as possible. And what you can see from that is that the hair is, it's actually incredibly saturated compared to when you have the specular highlights on. The saturation level for the hair is incredibly high. So this is something that we found out when we were putting together this scene, was that our albedo value for the hair when we first started on it was incredibly low. We thought it needed to be quite dark to get this kind of this blonde look, but actually it needs to be very, very well saturated. The thing to bear in mind is that then gets darkened when you apply the highlight over the top. It then darkens it down on its own. That's the physically based part of it, is the reflection kind of takes away some of that vibrance when it hits. So that's just one thing to bear in mind when you're working with hair, is the albedo really needs to be quite saturated and vibrant, and then you can work with your reflective details.
Right, and there really shouldn't be a whole lot of like painted in detail generally in this sort of like. So if you want to have really nice lighting on your hair, it kind of works against it to have really like specifically painted in lighting and highlights in the diffuse channel of your hair texture.
Yeah, if I just zoomed in like really far here, you can see it's pretty much, you know, the same kind of tones across everything, except for where the filter hasn't picked up particular highlights. But yeah, it's very consistent across the entire thing. But as soon as you turn on those highlights, you see you get this like incredibly broad range of hues that you're looking at, and that's all down to the specular reflectivity.
Yeah, so that's where you get most of the variation. Unless you have like a character who has like a natural hair color and then like highlights or something, where there's like something that's been done to the hair to make it look different, right?
Yeah.
Or like a faded, like a gradual dye, like a gradual red to black dye or something like that. So here I just set up some, just like a gradient basically in the hair, so that as the dyed blonde hair kind of transitions into the natural darker hair, that you just have like that gradient in the just the natural root color comes in. Like, so those are like the kind of things you want to think about when you're authoring diffuse content for hair, more so than like painting in individual hair detail.
We've got a question on YouTube. Is there going to be an undo button or key? We have an undo button.
Yes, we have
key.
Undo. Control Z.
Control Z is undo.
It's actually undo and redo. They're in the menu and everything too. Yeah, this has been in since, I think a couple versions ago we got it in. But yes, undo is a thing, and it's very nice to have. It was a pain when it wasn't in. All right, so that's... skin, eyes, hair. So those are basically the main components of the shader setup that you're going to generally deal with for a character model. So now I just want to talk a little bit about lighting. And I want to go back to... I think it's really important to think of the skylight as... It's the ambient contribution. So like in photography, you would think of it as like the fill light or like the ambient light, and you can kind of control the contrast between the shadows of your other lights by adjusting the skylight intensity. So like as we increase the ambient light, we watch out these shadows, right? And if we want to make the shadows very contrasty, you want to have a very moody, contrasty look when we really dial down the ambient light. And I think a few people have asked for like shadow strength settings, but what this is what you actually really want, is you want to control your ambient light, which will, in result, control the contrast of the shadows. I'll just go through the various lights that I have set up here. When I set up characters, I like to really just first off place a main key light that's kind of at a 45 and just a little off angle. So you get really that real specific little nose shadow, like the little Rembrandt shadow, I think it's actually called. So that's that light. I've got a light here just to hit off of the hair, just to give it that sheen. And I've got another light here that's just like a really harsh rim light, just so that you catch that that reflection on the edge right there like that. And I think that looks really cool. Let's see if I can get the body in here. So I really like a real strong and bright rim light to really highlight the silhouette, right? So you get that really nice look. And then back to this little ear light that I have, just to fake that translucency effect. Again, you have to turn the shadows off to really see it, but and then really dial the radius in. So you're just hitting the ear there, and so that's my basic light setup. You can set up your lights however you want. Really, there's like an unlimited amount of ways that you could do this, but this is how I generally do it. When I'm working with characters, I like to work with spotlights pretty much almost exclusively. Like, I'll use the image-based lighting to control the ambient light, but I really want to have really direct control with my lights and placement, so you can really, really nail where your shadows are showing up exactly and what the light is hitting exactly. You can set up your lighting much more quickly just by using the built-in tools here for just dropping point lights or directional lights in. But I find that this is kind of it's kind of too much of a blunt instrument when it comes to like lighting characters. So I usually like to do it all pretty much by hand.
Could you explain where you kind of what your kind of background is with lighting, like why you take this
particular approach? So like most of my background and understanding of lighting comes from photography and really nothing to do with games. So like whenever I talk about lighting, the big thing that I want people to understand is that like you shouldn't really worry so much about like the technical stuff. Like if you want to learn a lot about lighting, find tutorials or books on portrait lighting for photography, studio lighting, all that sort of things, because all of the same concepts of like what a key light is, what a fill light is, what a rim light is, how to place them, how to kind of sculpt the character with light to show the forms of the model, those are all really basic photography and lighting techniques. So I think there's a lot of overlap that, and usually you can find a lot better resources if you search for lighting in relation to photography, as opposed to like lighting in relation to games, which mostly you'll just find tutorials about like the technical stuff as opposed to the artistic side of lighting. So yeah, check out photography books, lighting, studio lighting books, tutorials, all that sort of stuff. There's a lot of information in there, and a lot of it applies kind of directly to lighting in games or in film, CG or regular film, you know. All that sort of stuff it all overlaps. And then speaking of photography, I just want to talk a little bit quickly here about cameras. And so one thing that is very important when you're setting up your camera for a character is to choose a focal length or a field of view that is kind of, that's a bit longer. What happens when you choose a really short focal length, like I'm gonna put a 12 millimeter focal length in here, and then you zoom in on the character, you get this really unnatural perspective distortion, like as if you, like almost like a fisheye lens. And this is just, it's not flattering to people in real life, and it's not flattering to your character models. So I like to use, like, if I'm going for like a full body shot, around somewhere around a 50 millimeter lens or like a 27 degree field of view. What this does is it you get a narrower field of view, so you have to move the camera further away. And the further the camera is away from an object, and this is true again in photography and in rendering, the less visible the perspective distortion is. So so for like a full body, I'll do like a 50 millimeter for a tighter headshot. I will tend to use like a 85 millimeter, which is really a standard kind of portrait lens in photography as well. In the latest version, we've got we actually switched up the middle mouse to actually adjust the field of view, so you can adjust that on the fly with the mouse too. And we might switch this back. People are kind of annoyed with it. We might set it to like control mouse wheel or something, but it's just a really quick way to change perspective while you're working without having to go to the sliders and everything. Well, we're in cameras, I want to show just some real quickly how the depth of field works. So the depth of field is a great way to really like isolate, like for instance, a character's eyes or any point you want to emphasize. And something that people may not know is that if you middle click on any point in the scene, it'll autofocus to that point, which is a really cool feature we added in one of the recent releases. And also we have this sticky focus setting here. I think this is off by default. But once you've got your focus nailed in and turn sticky focus on, as you zoom out, it will attempt to maintain that focus. So it's really useful for recomposing a camera after so you don't have to adjust this. Like I'd never use this little focal distance slider anymore now that we got the autofocus thing in and the sticky focus, because it's just really super handy.
Cool.
So that is pretty much it. I have a couple more questions here. First, does Toolbag 2.0 support animation? We do not currently. It's something that we want to do. It's just a matter of resources. We want to do it well, and we have a lot of other cool stuff that we're working on, and I think you guys are going to be really excited to see. So animation is, it's really not a question of if, but a matter of when we can find the time and resources to implement a solid animation system. We'd like to get some sort of animation system that imports mesh data from Alembic. Is that the final format, Lee? Yeah, I think it's Alembic. And we'll probably look at doing some simple like camera and object keyframing too when we get into the animation system. It's just a matter of time. We've got some other cool stuff that we're working on right now. And there's another question here, how to render a good turntable. When I tried, the process seems a bit buggy. We used to have a couple bugs with this. But I'll go over the basic process here. These little sliders here can be used to preview the turntable. And one of the things to note is that wherever you place the object on the screen, I believe this is true, that it will still rotate around the origin of the scene. So at least for the camera turntable type. You can do the sky if you just want to rotate the lighting. And a really neat trick there is if you've placed some dynamic lights manually, just parent them to the sky, just drag them onto the sky object, and then while the sky turntable rotates around, it'll move those lights as well. And then the scene will just rotate in place, and again, it'll, no matter where you put it on the screen, it'll rotate from the origin, which is kind of a limitation or a benefit depending on how you want to look at it. I just set up in this little animation tab the sort of turntable that I want, and then you go to turntable or capture and then settings, and then you can down here you can set it to the appropriate one if you want to do the sky, camera, or scene rotation. And then you can set up the frame rate and duration. All that is pretty straightforward. You can also, if you use a format that supports it like PSD or Targa, you can export it with transparency. So if you want to load a different background in, you can comp that in Premiere or wherever you want to do it. We previously had a bug where with certain turntable rotation modes, either the lighting or the model would jump to the incorrect position when you actually ran the turntable, but those have been fixed now. So the turntable stuff should be pretty straightforward. If that didn't answer your question, just ask me on Polycount again, and I'll see if I can give you more details.
I think that's about covers everything, doesn't it?
Yeah, I think that covers about everything. Just quickly before we log off here, just want to thank Yuri Alexander again for donating his awesome model here. It really made this process a lot easier for me to have some great art content to demo all these features on. And you guys should check out his site, yurialexander.com. I think I put a link in the YouTube description, but if I haven't, I will make sure to do that. And thank Lee for hanging out and talking about some of this nerdy stuff with me. So I'm Joe Wilson for Marmoset, and Lee, do you have anything else to add?
No, I guess we're just about done. If anyone has any questions or comments, we have a thread on polycount.com that I'm sure we can put into the YouTube intro. You could ask on Twitter with @MarmosetCo, or you can ask me at Lee Devonald. And yeah, just show us some awesome artwork and have fun.
Yep. All right. Awesome. Thank you guys for tuning in, and I hope that this was interesting or informative, or hopefully both. So.